So good afternoon, everyone. Could I ask everyone to take their seats, please, or just to remain seated as you all seated anyway now. Great pleasure to have you here today. And to have you here today means that we are welcoming scholars and experts from really pretty much around the world to launch an institute that's been in operation and active already for close to 2 years. And so I will try not to take any time away from our wonderful speakers, but I will have to say a few words about the institute and what we've been doing here so far. And once I'm finished with that, in 2 hours from now, then I will ask the speakers to come forward and take their seats. Okay, in order to do this properly, I actually brought notes, which I usually try not to do, but here we go. So, we are welcoming today speakers that come from the UK, from US, from Germany, Switzerland, France, and Argentina, and they will share their views and understanding as well as their questions in relation to whether there is a transnational law and how it might look like. But then most of all, I want to thank the people that have made this possible and have also made possible the last 1.5 years. And within the law school, which is just adjacent to this building, the Dickson Poon School of Law, we refer to them as professional staff, but we also refer to them as the people in minus one. That sounds scary, but it's just referring to that they're in the floor underneath the ground floor. And they all sit in this room. It's a bit like in Billy Wilder's office in 123. And they do amazing work. And they've helped me to settle in over the last 1.5 years. But most of all, they've helped to bring into reality this institute that we are celebrating today. And the institute has been very active, and I will say a few words about what the institute has been doing. But all of these things really have been done with the help of my colleagues in minus one. Most things we do in life are in fact group efforts. And so there's no this without that. And that is why stories of heroes or of heroines usually have a sour ring to them. And the achievements of the team in minus one, they are, like I just indicated, they are truly collective, with everyone there playing an incredible part in assuming responsibility for different pieces of the law school. It's demanding, and many students, many of them are here today, it's oftentimes aberrant faculty, as well as many other stakeholders. Programs get created somehow, by fiat, by whim, or by wit. But they get executed, put in place, shepherded, and cared for by real people who have the patience and dedication to see them through. And so, yes, without being allowed to single anyone out, I still would like to do just that, if only to pay tribute to the person without whom there would be no Transnational Law Institute, and also none of the events as this one today. That is Helen Bandawi. Where is Helen? So there's Helen, the wonderfully calm, amazingly competent, and staggeringly unflappable institute coordinator. I learned that word from her, because I said, how do you know? Everybody refers to her as being unflappable. She never loses her calm. She's always in control of all of these things. Now, after mentioning some of the important people under the rubric of by whom are these things, programs, events done, we need to turn our attention to the for whom. And here, above all, I want to thank the wonderful students who helped today and in the background of so many other projects and events that go on in the institute and around it. The students today are drawn from this year's LLM program in transnational law. They come themselves from around the world, and they have been contributing wonderfully to the life of the institute. You can read some of their testimonies of their experiences at the law school and in the program and with each other in this brochure, which we basically prepared until 2 hours ago. It's like a newspaper. Everything is very up to date here. So there will be an opportunity to thank the students and Helen more appropriately after our talks. But then there's also another group to whom we owe particular thanks, and that's a group of young musicians that one of the students Marius has wonderfully organized, and they will not only perform a few songs for us live afterwards, but they also brought a whole bag of digitized music for us for our entertainment. So let me say a few more words about the students, the Institute, and then about tonight's program. Let me highlight and note with the greatest emphasis the fact that the students are indeed the lifeblood of a project such as the TLI, as they and the Institute organically form and become part of a law school, a university, and of an academic conversation across London, the UK, and beyond. In that, these amazing, hardworking, and open-minded students, daring as they are also part of an emerging generation of young legal professionals with a particular dilemma. They are most assuredly better trained and experienced than most of us have ever been. They are drawn into language courses, internships and practicums, exchanges and travels from the start of their education. And yet, they are bound to leave the institutions and their teachers with more questions than they had before. They enter a world which is in deep trouble, in terrible disarray in terms of socioeconomic inequality, unequal access to material as well as political opportunities to attempt and or even maybe fulfill a human being's potential to self-realization, a world with a host of threats, risks, and problems that are directly before them and not just at the far horizon. And that's a world that's daunting and indeed overwhelming. It's a world of greatest uncertainty with high risks and high stakes. The law student today studies this world around her in small, often disconnected pieces, but now is pushed out to embark onto a professional career and life path under precarious conditions. In the midst of the second decade of the 21st century, we can witness our students inhabiting an environment that knows many of the same issues, constraints, challenges, large and small, that we have known as well. Deciding on a subject, finding a place where to study that subject, applying, begging for funds to pay for education, finding a room or a flat, making friends, but also feeling lonely and lost, and more, it seems, being under enormous pressure to be and to become ever more somebody special. To be even better than the kid next to one, to be even better connected to future employers, better versed in scouting job and summer placement opportunities, in curving the ball in the avalanche of classes, papers, and exams, and meanwhile trying to stay healthy. But there's something much more that is going on. It comes to them via the constant chatter, imagery, Twittery, and Instagrammery, through Facebook alerts and texts that appear on the phone, the literally handheld device that their parents might have given them so that the kid would keep in touch while being away from home, studying at university or just in another part of town. Well, that whole thing, the notion of being away and being away from home, has become more than relative to our students today, if not precarious. Where in the world am I today? Which are my foundations, my firm beliefs, the people I can trust and rely on? Where am I and where am I going to? How did I make that choice and the one before? Will I get a job? Should I take a class that interests me? And why does it really interest me? Or should I take the classes that most of my classmates have opted for? Does it help me to move with the crowd, or do I fight for my own and on my own? We are all familiar with such preoccupations of the mind in some way. Students express them in office hours, and we remember these feelings all too well ourselves. The anxieties alone could keep a student in his or her 20s busy enough, we all agree. But there's clearly something else that students struggle with, and it appears that it dominates and looms much larger than many of the other existential personal concerns. But what that is in fact hard to pin down, for the fear of being irrational, or perhaps even sentimental. After all, the world they are growing up in is one in which many references that stand for the particular defining quality of the 20th century seem to have no longer the same meaning, except as one of being maybe a historical datum. Today's students would not find it remarkable in any way that in the 1980s a book made a great troubling observation. Ulrich Beck's study of risk society hit the spot in a world where we were experiencing the last gasps of a retreating welfare state and we were thrown into a universe of individualization and responsabilization. These developments were questioned and fought against the long-held beliefs in collective action, in state-protected forms of industrial pluralism and a lively democratic culture. Today, in fact, we know that the future then was only the early expression of a neoliberalization of the world and its social and political structures everywhere. This is the world we now inhabit. In this world of today's students, the risks they are being aware of and which we are all facing today in an incredible manner largely surpass the frontier that was the 20th century central and most dominating one, the nuclear. While this threat still continues, it has become normal. It has become accepted as a fact of life, or at least only one of the many things we are worrying about. What has become a fact of life is a world marked by a distinct proliferation of such risks. These are risks that require reactions, risks that provoke the public to call on our profession to come up with adequate regulatory responses, to find solutions, and to work towards a good outcome. Such risks manifest themselves in terms of planetary destruction and the depletion of natural resources, of a perversely grown gap between those who have and those who have not, and of an abyss between competing visions of the good, the right, and the true, perhaps even justice, as we lawyers might still say, even if not as loudly and self-confidently anymore. Of an abyss, then, that seems to only harden rather than effectively challenge and transform the views on respective sides, due perhaps to an increasingly uncontrollable and radicalizing fear of losing dearly held safety nets of values, communal habits, and routines. But only are such safety nets considered precious, not only because we experience them as such, but because the memory is fresh of the struggle to fight for them, for their establishment and preservation. It is at that point that any student today will begin to ask a simple question that many of her teachers did only too rarely come across at all or in their training more recently. That is, who really is doing the asking? Who really is the we that we are constantly referring to? Who is the subject in the sentence? Who is expressing his or her fear of not being able to confront so-called global, that is, world-spanning, all-affecting, universally acknowledged risks, such as environmental destruction or security or terrorism? Every student experiences such an itch of necessary irony today, a stance of realism and self-limitation that many others, and certainly many among the older generation of the past 3-4 decades, have come across only much more recently. Students today strike me as sobered, realistic, and perhaps even disillusioned, and certainly anxious about their place in the world. But above all, they strike me as anything but naive as to the challenges they face in actually making the very thing that every commercialized education program promises today to enable them to, which is a contribution. The value of achievement, career, self-fulfillment has become questionable, at least. After years of educating them about materialism and consumerism and the dark role that the rich and powerful West has been playing in the lives of those fellow humans in the colonial, post-colonial, exploited and dominated global South. Given our students' skepticism about the authenticity and legitimacy of their own voice and of the bias of their worldview, and their growing concern that whoever is speaking about global challenges, etc., might be and is, in fact, not speaking for the global majority, but only for an elite miniature selection of the world's population, we can hardly be surprised that even law students are much less self-confident today about their mandate, their competence, and their authority. What we have come here today for is to shed some light on a year or more of collective experiments and practices in reflecting on ways in which law and lawyers might be able to reorient their views on legal education, legal practices, the needs of students and those of the profession, the so-called market, and even society at large, in a world that lawyers have for far too long been studying, dominating, and managing through a very narrow Western lens. The Transnational Law Institute was created in the summer of 2014 through the enormously generous gift of Sir Dickson Poon, and it has as its mandate nothing less than to make the law school now named after its benefactor a transnational one. And if you leave the law school, you can see there's a quote by Dickson Poon on the wall that says that it's about to educate transnational lawyers for a global world today. What my colleagues and the law school, and most importantly the students, have been doing since then includes the following. We've collectively created a new transnational law LLM pathway, which we lovingly refer to T3LM. Since September 2014, it offered 20 courses, 18 of which were brand new. They were created in the few months prior to the opening of the program by scholars that had not been previously teaching in transnational law. In September 2015, we started with 24 courses, and in a few months, September 2016, we'll have on offer 27 modules. These courses include courses in public and private, domestic and international law, with a large emphasis on practice relevancy, but most importantly, and complementing the practice relevancy, critical interdisciplinary thinking, and an acknowledgement that there are more than one viewpoint, more than one approach to finding the right solution, and that the lawyer does not see it all and needs to challenge herself through an engagement with other knowledges, literatures, and stakeholders. Our program includes courses in sociology of law, legal philosophy, the law of war, refugee law, and law of climate change governance. Next to courses in corporate governance, financial market regulation, bankruptcy, property, or criminal law. Some of these courses are cross-listed with other LLM pathways, including business and finance, dispute resolution, and EU law, but also with the Department of War Studies, and now starting this fall, the International Development Institute, one of King's shining global institutes with a thriving MA program in development studies. The next generation of future academics, the PhD students, form the second great and important constituency of the TLI. TLI events, we've had many of those in the last 1.5 years, and some of those have been created by PhD students themselves, and also are shepherded by standing research groups, including the Transnational Regulatory Governance Research Group that's led by Stephen Minnis, who is a PhD candidate here and will speak today. He has also started to collaborate with students in the political economy department and does more for inter-college collaboration than some of us as established scholars. We also, together with my dear colleague Prabha Kutisvaran, we created in 2015, it seems ages ago, it's only one summer ago, we created a summer institute for PhD students that come from all over the world, and we have them engage with each other and with selected faculty in 5 to 6 different disciplines, including anthropology, political science, and others, on their own work, but also with themes of great relevance for 2 weeks every summer. And we started with 52 fellows last summer, and this coming summer we have 66, to the large chagrin of all of us, because we wonder how we will please all of these, but we are happy that they are all want to come. Another event that the TLI started is a long-standing reading group now that meets on a monthly basis and brings together students in the LLM, PhD program, and faculty, but all across London, really the reading laboratory, out of which grew a big conference this past March. We also have a seminar series where scholars do not present the substance of their work, but rather focus on explaining how they conceived of their research project, the so-called methods laboratory. Students have also been involved in editing the Transnational Law Theory Quarterly Law Review and have made very important contributions. So now, as we turn to the program for today, it's our conviction that the program today builds seamlessly on what we've been doing so far. As you will see from the lineup of our prestigious speakers, but also from the topics that they will address. So in the next 1.5 hours or so, we will have speakers that are comprised of experts in labor and law and development, in trade, in comparative constitutional law, in social legal studies and ethnography, in climate change law, as well as in international law and diplomacy. But we also have experts here in political science and political theory, in critical geography and anthropology, in global and transnational history, and in third world approaches to international law. Taken together, learning from each other, and looking across and thinking across boundaries, all of these scholars seem to be doing one thing pretty well, which is transnational law. Thank you so much for coming today. And now I ask our speakers, the first five speakers, because we only seem to have five chairs, and then we'll do a quick rotation. Is that okay? Good, thank you so much. And the floor is now yours.
So much to Per for his introduction, and for the past 18 months, I also particularly want to thank Prabha Kotaswaran, because my main engagement with the Transnational Law Institute was with the Summer Institute last year, which they organise, and I both attended, and two of my doctoral supervisees attended and had a fantastically enriching time talking about their own work and listening to others. So. For today we were asked to talk about the origins and current state of the debate around transnational law as a field of legal doctrine. So these are Per's instructions, the field of legal doctrine or global practice, and also to reflect on the role of law in governing cross-border activities. So that's already been mentioned. In this particular session, as you'll see, the title is The Focus is on Politics and Markets. So what I want to do with that, those instructions, despite the fact that it's a self-regulatory forum, is to explore first, and this is a really basic question which I realise I'm not actually going to answer, but the first question is how we might conceptualise transnational law. Is it a subject area, a field, like private international law, or is it a method, an intellectual approach to a given topic? And I want to sort of answer that question, or perhaps not answer that question, by focusing on something more substantive, which is to examine the question of how we might define or understand transnational law by reference to how it relates to my area of interest, my subdiscipline, which is labour law. So this question, which I don't think I have the answer to, but I'm actually pretty sure that a lot of the students here do, which is transnational law as a field or as a method. So the term isn't new, and as you know, a key reference point is a series of lectures delivered by Philip Jessop in 1956 at Yale Law School, published as a book of that name. So as simple as we might think of transnational law as attempting to define a field, yes, rules emerging from private or public sources which regulate actions and events that transcend national frontiers. But even then, even in 1956, clearly there was something more sophisticated going on, that the label was also seen as offering a new approach to international law, suggesting a theoretical or methodological orientation. So in other words, and this is perhaps my approach to it, transnational law is conceived of as a site or a location from which one can think more clearly about pluralism, a way to understand plural sources of normmaking, plural legal regimes, and the fragmentation of law away from nation states. So, as I said, in this session, we're focusing on what transnational law might mean for politics and markets. And for me, when I think and write about transnational law, it's by reference to the changing relationships between the law, between law and economy at national, regional, and I guess we're going to say transnational level. In thinking about what transnational law means for markets, and perhaps for the governance of markets, I find it useful to consider transnational law in relation to what we might call economic law. And that's because the sphere of economic interaction is increasingly being deterritorialized, moved away from territorial jurisdiction. Now, I first came across the term economic law when I was doing my PhD at the European University Institute in Florence, and in particular as deployed by German scholars such as Christian Jurgis, who really helpfully would point out that the term economic law can't adequately be translated into English. And what he meant by that was the term economic law is more familiar to civilian legal systems, especially that of Germany, which has a particular historical and political heritage, but at its simplest, that the sort of German or civilian law understanding of economic law, and it will relate to transnational law in a minute, if just bear with me. At its simplest, economic law refers to the regulation of the economy, so law which institutionalizes markets and provides for their functioning. So potentially this is really wide-ranging. It can encompass private economic legislation, corporate law, property law, competition, and merger regulation, as well as general private law, the law of public economic administration, product safety regulation, which covers the regulation of the ability of a product to enter the market. And so economic law is something which we think about as both constituting and regulating markets. And instead, it's so broad that it also includes social regulation. So in my area of interest, labour and social welfare law, also environmental law. But as someone who's long researched regional integration, in particular in the context of the European Union and now the context of the African Union, it's clear to me that economic law has been relocated to a different level of decision making, away from the state. And in the past I would have talked about economic law being Europeanized, and now perhaps also internationalized. It's no longer confined to the national jurisdiction. Product regulation, product safety legislation, is not, if you're a member state of a trading bloc such as the EU, is not confined to the national plane. So for me, transnational law involves thinking about the increasingly trans-territorial nature of regulatory governance. And as a labor lawyer, for me, transnational law can be broadly understood to encompass national, regional, and cross-border labor law, and in particular, the study of those norms under conditions of trade liberalization and the fragmentation of governance. So moving on to sort of applying that approach to the context of transnational labor law and also in the context of development. So labor lawyers tend to be preoccupied with one of the key projects for labor law is relates to how can we constrain market power? And a concern for the regulatory means or institutions by which the market can be governed or contained. And traditionally, labor law narratives have emerged from the political economy of hegemonic states of the global north, in that what constitutes what labor law can do in constraining market power has been very much determined by what was going on in the political economy of those dominant hegemonic states of the industrialized countries. And traditional labor law narratives were very closely allied to a particular economic history of regulation in primarily Fordist productive relations and to forms of regulation which evolved along with the protected capacities of industrialized states during the 20th century. So in particular, regulatory mechanisms which presuppose formal work relations, work relations which are visible to the state as a regulator, you know, work which is regular for an employer who is, for example, a registered economic actor, okay, rather than informal work activities which might be sort of below the radar of the regulator. And this also, traditional labor law narratives also presuppose, crucially for this discussion of the transnational, presupposes the presence of a state with capacity to regulate a territorially bounded market. Okay. Now, that is a story which was perhaps relevant for some industrialized states and relevant for some actors in the labor market, some workers who conformed to the narrative of labor law regulating those in a very visible economy. It didn't really tackle what we call informal work, flexible work. It didn't encompass unpaid work, economic activity outside the labour market, and it certainly didn't really speak to labour as experience in developing economies. But an additional challenge for labour law, for thinking about labour law, is what we might call the deterritorialisation of labour law, which is the sort of the transnational story, because labour work now takes place under conditions of trade liberalisation, cross market integration, of increased cross-border economic activity. I'm aware about using the term globalization because we all use it and we don't really define it, but I want to think about this in terms of increased liberalization of trade in goods and services, increased financial flows, increased capital movements, to the point that financialization is a big determinant of governance. So we have this, what we might talk about as the sort of globalized economic activity, but also transnational movement of persons. However, you might have gathered this for yourself, the movement of workers is not facilitated in the same way as the flow of capital, of goods, of finance, of services. So that's the context in which labour now takes place, work now takes place under these conditions of trade liberalisation, of increased cross-border economic activity, but do the regulatory forms follow? Okay. Outside of the nation state, not necessarily, I have a minute left. Okay, so my interest in transnational labour law relates to the extent to which labour law and labour market institutions can provide a response, a counter movement, to those of you who are familiar with the language of Polanyi, to the liberalisation of trade and the opening of national borders. And I'm doing this also from the perspective of developing states as well as industrialised ones, and that's what I refer to by when I talk about telling stories about law and development. I just want to give one example, and this is from migrant work, and in particular migrant care work. Ali Hochschild, the sociologist, has coined the term global care chains to refer to a series of personalised links between peoples across the globe based on paid or unpaid work of caring. Global care chains, rather like global supply chains, are transnational networks formed for the purpose of maintaining daily lives, and social reproduction is outsourced. These networks comprise households that transfer their caregiving tasks across borders. So think about migrants from poorer countries going to work for households in wealthier economies. But the migrants, as I said, their movement is not facilitated in the same way that the movement of financial services or capital or goods are. And what one sees for me, the transnational labour law, is it's an intersection of law. Migrant workers for me represent people who are subject to multiple legal regimes governing their position, trade law, perhaps sometimes refugee law, human rights law, labour and equality law, perhaps even criminal law. However, the main problem for migrant workers is that the main legal regime governing their rights tend to defer to the other legal regimes, for example, the principle of state sovereignty over immigration policy, which accept the rights of states to impose restrictions on non-nationals' employment and in exchange for the privilege of entering the host territory. So I just want to conclude with this point kind of coming from what is transnational labour law, transnational labour law, and this example of migrant work, to end with an observation from Judy Ferd, which is she asked whether international labour law, migrant workers' instruments can be used to question, to map onto, or to challenge alternative regulatory regimes, alternative legal regimes, which seem to take priority when it comes to governing the rights and the experience of this particular group, because as they exit from a state, they exit from the governance of their states of origin, but the states of entry, their host states, are either unable to or unwilling to provide a replacement sort of governance regime. Okay, so I just want to end there. I think that's my 11 and a bit minutes. Sorry.
My thanks to Per for the invitation and my congratulations as well to him and his team for this remarkable institute that we're celebrating today. So my focus is going to be on the question of justice and how that interacts with a pluralist transnational legal order. That's not a 10-minute question. I'm going to take a subset of that and look from the perspective of international economic law and see how transnational legal processes pose certain risks from the perspective of the normative evaluation of economic activity or fairness, but also how there are certain opportunities as well. So I had hoped that Per would define transnational law for us at the beginning, since that's such a contentious subject, and I thought then he could take the heat for it and I could just piggyback on his definition. But since he didn't do that wisely, I will just offer a very broad definition of transnational law that I'm focusing my remarks on. And I would say it would be the process of norm creation without the necessary input of the state or without the imprimatur of the state, and yet which acquires authority and binding effect through a range of mechanisms. Now, what is the normative risk that this kind of process might offer? Well, it's this. Insofar as global justice theory or political theory about global issues have focused on the responsibilities and duties of states, either themselves as actors or from the perspective of states as agents operationalizing universal duties that we all hold, from either vantage point, the risk is that if we start developing more legal processes that, in a sense, bypass the state altogether or partially, that justice in that sense starts to go under the radar. And we don't have the tools necessarily developed to evaluate the fairness of mechanisms that are not essentially related to the state as an actor. So I want to give you an example of that, and if time permits, maybe two examples. We'll see if this turns out to be 10 minutes or a pair of 10 minutes. But I'm hoping it'll just be 10 minutes. The first example I would give you is something I would call regulatory arbitrage. So transnational law creates the possibility for powerful actors to self-select in terms of the regulatory scheme that they would like to be governed by and the regulator that they would like to be overseen by. That tends to be the weakest set of rules and the weakest regulatory body. And therefore, they are creating the possibility of risks to societies that might themselves have chosen a more onerous level of regulation or a stronger regulator, but yet which are bypassed through some of the transnational mechanisms of rule creation. So let me give you an example. And this is the example of AIG leading up to the global financial crisis. So AIG purchased a small savings and loan company, which seems innocent in and of itself, except that by purchasing the savings and loan company, AIG therefore came under the regulatory supervision of something called the Office of Thrift Supervision, which in the United States was the weakest economic regulator of the range of economic regulators in the United States. Well, to make matters worse, the EU recognized that level of regulation as equivalent to European regulation, therefore allowing AIG to also exercise its economic activities in Europe without supervision from a European Union regulator either. So the rest is history. But the key element to that for the perspective of what I'm talking about today is that we have regulators on both sides of the Atlantic failing to enforce what we could consider to be core principles of fairness in economic regulation. And I'm talking now about prudential regulation. So we can think of prudential regulation as involving principles of fairness in a couple of different ways. First and most generally, prudential regulation is a way of protecting the vulnerable from the powerful when actors with agency speculate with the assets of others. So a kind of fiduciary duty. We can also think of prudential regulation as a responsibility to correct anticipated market failures, which disproportionately impact the vulnerable. We can also think of prudential regulation as a state's responsibility to prevent transboundary harms, such as systemic financial collapse. On any of these grounds, I think it's fair to say that in the AIG case, transnational legal processes were exploited to the benefit of a few and the cost of many. So, what can we do about that? Well, I'm going to suggest a transnational kind of response to this transnational kind of risk. There are many other kinds of responses as well. So from a transnational perspective, we need to develop a comprehensive normative map of this new global space, a map that takes into account the responsibilities of non-state actors as well as state actors, non-state actors that have legal significance, such as private associations, and I'm thinking, for example, of something like the International Chamber of Commerce, or transnational regulatory bodies and transnational regulatory networks, such as the Basel Committee process. If we can map this global space from a normative point of view, then regardless of where and how specific norms come to be generated, we have at least some idea or some way to identify what would be the appropriate kinds of normative duties that would follow out of that particular process of norm creation. Now, I think this approach underscores why transnational law and the phenomena of transnational law in the broadest sense require a pluralist approach to global justice, an approach which recognizes that there are indeed a range of actors, a range of relationships, and a number of different grounds for justice present in the global space. Now, I've written about this, and it takes much more than 10 minutes to go into that, but I just want to mention two particular approaches out of this sort of transnational pluralist approach to justice. One is a relational approach to justice. In this approach, one's obligations of justice depend on being in certain relationships to others. For example, fellow participants in a global market society. So the transnational legal actor in that kind of relationship has normative duties that grow out of the relationship itself. So it doesn't depend on whether you're a state or not. It depends on being an entity that's in certain kinds of relationships with other actors. A second approach to justice would be a role-based approach to justice, where an entity's duties are a function of the allocative role that that entity is playing in a social environment. Like any traditional social institution, the key is that we're looking at transnational institutions and associations from the same perspective as we might have looked at domestic institutions. So for example, when a body like the WTO or the IMF is allocating trade rights or allocating reserve currencies, then they are themselves subject to principles of distributive justice as an allocative institution. Perhaps one could see how that might even apply to something as disaggregated as the Basel Committee process. Second point about this approach is that in the absence of comprehensive global institutions with plenary powers, civil society and academics play a very important role in helping to monitor transnational law norms for their consistency with broader social justice principles, however one defines them. So in conclusion, I would just say that I think this kind of normative reflection in the transnational legal space is very much in its infancy, but I think the urgency is very clear. In his work on transnational law, Cesar Arjona offers a view that transnational law enlarges the space for consideration of global justice within law, rather than decreasing it, insofar as positivism is often used as an excuse to eliminate normative reflection from law. Well, I'd like to think that that's true about transnational law, and I'm confident that the Institute and its programs are part of making sure that that indeed turns out to be the case. So, thank you.
Thank you. So I have the enviable task of talking about a sociolegal take on transnational law. And I do this from the vantage point of a public lawyer. I teach English criminal law here at King's, but I also research in the areas of feminist legal theory, post-colonial theory, and sociology of law. And I particularly pursue an ethnographic method in studying law. So my sociolegal take on transnational law today is to pose the question of whether sociolegal scholars and transnational lawyers are fellow travelers or whether they are interlocutors. And by fellow traveler, I mean a person who sympathizes with the beliefs of an organization or cooperates in its activities without maintaining formal membership in that particular group. Interlocutors, on the other hand, are those who are in conversation or a dialogue with each other. Now, admittedly, I think the socio-legal tent is quite large, but I can imagine many socio-legal scholars who are probably sympathetic to the challenges of transnational law and transnational lawyers, but really are probably no more than fellow travelers for a project like the TLI. For transnational lawyers, on the other hand, I think socio-legal studies is a crucial touchstone, whether we consider the work of Schaefer and Halliday on transnational legal orders or even Pierce's extensive work on transnational law. So indeed, we've had many socio-legal luminaries really grace the corridors of the TLI in the past 2 years. But I think it's fair to say that in most law schools around the world, traditional and doctrinal legal scholars are likely to view socio-legal and transnationalist lawyers as really one in the same virus, really that compromises the health of a law faculty. And I think for the most part, they're right, not about compromising the health of the law faculty, but really as us having enough synergies to be meaningful interlocutors. So I want to briefly reflect on the areas of convergence between these two fields before speaking of the experimental interlocutory spaces that the TLI has actually facilitated here at King's, not just for research, but I think importantly also pedagogically, through both the transnational law pathway, but also the Transnational Law Summer Institute that Pierre has already mentioned that we co-convene. So substantively speaking, I think Pierre has told us for a very long time now that transnational law is not really a legal field. It's much more of a methodology, which is elaborated by an examination of actors, norms, and processes in relation to a particular legal problem. And I think viewed this way, socio-legal studies and transnational legal studies share several common preoccupations. So I'll just mention a few here. One would be a deep appreciation for the co-constitutive relationship between law and society. One would be to embrace legal pluralism and take seriously the role of non-state actors in non-generation. Another would be a commitment to interdisciplinary scholarship. And a final one would be a keen commitment to demystifying many of the myths of modern law through the use of critical legal and legal realist tools, especially by destabilizing the distinctions between public-private, state, non-state, law, non-law. And indeed, my colleagues and I explore many of these themes in the courses that we teach as part of the transnational law pathway. And I'm involved in two of them, and I'm just quite struck by the comments that Diamond has already made about how transnational labor law invokes a whole range of other areas of the law. And I think that is our experience as well in teaching transnational and international criminal law, which I co-teach with a colleague who's not here, Dr. Nicola Palmer. And we encounter similar issues when we teach sociology of law, and I co-teach this with Professor David Nelkin, who's here. We view this course very much as complementing the core transnational law course and offering a strong theoretical foundation for transnational legal studies. And I just want to say a little bit about how teaching on the pathway also influences our research here as academics at King's. And I'll try to illuminate this through two of the projects that I'm currently involved in. One is a book on human trafficking, where I found that actually transnational legal studies is a very useful legal tool for making sense of this very vexed legal problem. And to give you some idea of the problem, you know, we are told that there are 35.8 modern slaves around the world who are victims of trafficking. And trafficking itself is used to describe very different phenomena. I mean, we're familiar with the more sort of egregious cases of trafficking, but you'd be surprised to know that actually we could use the term trafficking to also refer to forced laborers who have been involved in supply chains to produce any number of commodities that you and I have consumed today, whether it's cocoa, sugar, cotton, shrimp, name it. So although there is an instrument of transnational criminal law, the Palermo Protocol, which is meant to target trafficking, and which was ratified at lightning speed across the world, in fact, it's resulted in very few convictions. So the transnational lawyer here has a diagnostic role, which is quite wide-ranging and raises more questions than we can ever hope to answer in what is a very fluid and highly dynamic field. So for instance, what is trafficking? It turns out we actually don't know. We might look to the Palermo Protocol, or we might look to how countries around the world have actually operationalized definitions of movement in the context of coercion and exploitation. Which is the relevant UN body to deal with trafficking? We don't know. Should it be the UN Office on Drugs and Crime, or should it be the ILO? Should we resort to transnational criminal law, or labor law, or migration law, or human rights law, or trade law? And I think here there are overlaps with what Diamond has already said in the context of migrant care work. The question seems to be, the burning normative question seems to be really, do we aim for retribution, or do we aim for redistribution? And the even more important question is resorting to the law even worthwhile? Given that actually the real drivers of change in this area are corporations, they are philanthropo-capitalists and non-entrepreneurs who have their whole range of trafficking, forced labor, and modern slavery indicators. So I could perform a very similar analysis for another area of law that I'm working on, namely transnational commercial surrogacy. So 20 years ago, the British Parliament could simply say, well, commercial surrogacy is nothing but baby selling, so we will ban it, right? But today, and I think this goes to what Frank has already said about regulatory arbitrage, that position is simply not sustainable because, in fact, until recently, numerous countries like India, Thailand, and Nepal could simply meet this demand for couples who wanted to complete their families. And it's quite interesting how not only reproductive labor in this case is outsourced to the global south, but also all the legal headaches and the normative conundrums that countries like the UK would prefer not to deal with are also actually outsourced. So I think any plausible investigation of an issue of this sort by a transnational lawyer would need to engage quite seriously with the political economy of surrogacy markets, the vast range of background legal rules that would actually shape the surrogacy market, how actors generate norms to self-regulate within this industry, especially when states are not very forthcoming, and ultimately, how do we decide who wins, who loses, and what should the law do? Right. So I think understanding and responding to complex issues such as trafficking and commercial surrogacy requires literally every conceptual tool and explanatory device that we can lay our hands on. And I think there seems to be no choice, really, but to approach law in a sociological manner in a transnational context. So I'll conclude with saying a little bit about the Summer Institute, which was a new pedagogical adventure that we embarked on last year. And as Pierre has already mentioned, we brought, I have a different number, but a substantial number of future law teachers to King's, working on a whole range of issues such as climate change, gender violence, global food security, and migration. And we had an equally fascinating group of faculty members who came from numerous disciplines and from around the world to engage with our TLC fellows, as we call them. And I think what we had was certainly a lot of intellectual work that got done during the Institute, but also numerous professional development sessions that really made us ask, what would it take today to be a high quality academic and teacher, but also to remain socially and politically relevant? So I'm actually quite delighted that we have, I think, three of our TLC fellows here today with us. And we meet again this June with 65 or 66 TLC fellows. What I want to say is that the learning at TLC, or certainly this is an aspirational statement, I think, does not happen unidirectionally. So it's not the idea that we have ideas flowing from an educational institution, which is in the global north, and then we have academics coming from the global south. I think here again, we take our cue from socio-legal studies, which is, I think anyway, witnessing a post-colonial turn from Santos's epistemologies of the south to Mariana Valverde's idea of the chronotopes, to Eve Darian Smith's call for global social legal studies. And I think so we embrace the productive chaos of these 2 weeks in June, where we hope that the exchange of thoughts and ideas would flow in many different directions, ultimately with the hope of fostering epistemic breaks, but also trying to reconstruct and develop from the ground up new vocabularies for what we hope will be a truly transnational field of legal studies.
So I want to say thank you to the organizers, to Per and Helen, for inviting me here today. And as a former fellow of the Summer Institute, I'm really honored to speak at the launch of TLI, which in its short lifespan has really already established itself as a groundbreaker in the study of the emerging field of transnational legality, but also a pioneer in critical new methodologies to the study of law through its empirical and interdisciplinary and reflexive approach to socio-legal analysis. So as an anthropologist, I'm particularly excited to be here. Anthropology and law have had a long, mutually enriching relationship since the development of socio-legal studies and the founding of legal realism. Indeed, in their study of the law ways of the Cheyenne, an indigenous population in the central United States, E. Adamson Hobel, an anthropologist, and Carl Llewellyn, a prolific legal scholar, devised a new method for understanding law from below. They focused on everyday disputes, or trouble cases, as they called them, as windows into the larger normative order, developing an approach to legal analysis that would serve as the foundation for both anthropological and critical legal analysis of the space between law's representation of itself and its empirical operation. And since 1941, when the Cheyenne Way was published, complex global transformations have obviously produced an emerging transnational order that is radically different from the dyadic and interpersonal disputes of the Cheyenne people. But nonetheless, like the Cheyenne, we live in a world of plural and overlapping legal orders which compete to exert power in our complex normative order, global normative order. And so ethnographic methods, those that examine law in its micro-interactional contexts, I think can provide profound insights into the macro-sociological production and competition over the field of transnational law. So today I'd like to talk a little bit and draw on some of my research from my own disciplinary location as an ethnographer of transnational legal orderings to offer some comments about the critical importance of empirical and engaged legal scholarship in the field of transnational legality. So for the past 2 years, I've been engaged in a multi-sided study of food governance on local and global scales in the United States and in the UN. And I've been looking at how new technologies as well as representations of transnational law have transformed the operation, exercise, and forms of global power. In excavating the cultural symbols that animate the production of transnational law, I've focused on the network, a depiction of social relations that has ascended from a descriptive schema to an ideology of social and economic regulation. Indeed, the network offers a really powerful image of society and economy as a non-hierarchical, inclusive, and unbounded social field in the global world. Yet, while transnational social movements, or corporations and legal reformers have all adopted the network imaginary, each imbue it with distinct meanings and social practices. For transnational agrarian movements, which I study, the network's egalitarian and horizontal structure offers a vision of global democracy. For transnational corporations, the network offers a form of collaborative competition in an era of global economic volatility. And for transnational law reformers, the network offers a technology to settle disputes and endows institutions with greater credibility and legitimacy. So today, as the network emerges as a hegemonic but contested representation of transnational society and economy, how do these competing meanings and practices shape the field of transnational law? And what forms of power does the network produce as it is embedded in new forms of governance? These questions have really animated my ethnographic study of food governance, which took me to the UN Committee on World Food Security, the body tasked with global food policy. And since conflicts over food and agriculture are symbolic and material struggles over the organization of society and economy, the legal field of food governance reflects conflicts in this emerging normative order. Indeed, sociologist Jason Moore tells us that conflicts over food and agriculture are the decisive battleground over neoliberalism. The CFS was founded, the Committee on World Food Security, was founded as an intergovernmental body after the first world food crisis in 1974, which was a moment that really revealed the degree to which states had become dependent on global markets to meet their basic needs. After the second world food crisis in 2008, the CFS undertook an institutional reform to take on this idea of network governance through a multi-stakeholder structure that reflects these new models of governance. And social movements really welcomed and encouraged this reform because they now have a seat at the table, but they've now found themselves disappointed by the outcomes of the standards they negotiate. While one might argue that this is the result of instrumental efforts by powerful governments and corporations to shape these negotiations, I'd like to suggest that it, in fact, is the network's underlying structure and its horizontal representation of social and economic values that is transforming the organization of state, society, and market, and implicitly constituting a new transnational normative order by concealing hierarchies of value and power. And drawing on a dispute processing or processual approach, as we call it, of legal anthropology is helpful here, because it's demonstrated that there's a mutually constitutive relationship between the structure of disputing and between the norms which emerge from it. So by examining the context of one dispute in the CFS, we might therefore see how the structure of the network is shaping the types of norms and outcomes produced through this field. So as by way of an example, in 2013, 2014, I was a participant observer in the CFS negotiations over the principles of responsible agricultural investment, a non-binding set of standards that were really developed in response to transnational grain movements that were mobilizing in response to land grabs, which have proliferated particularly in sub-Saharan Africa. And over the course of these negotiations, it became clear to me that this wasn't just about land grabs, this dispute. In fact, it was about the representation of, it was a semiotic struggle over the representation of global and local food systems. And this was clear particularly when it came to negotiations over the word farmer, which is something that we take for granted. Activists really sought to make clear a distinction between the values maintained by smallholders, those that privilege autonomy and subsistence, in contrast to the values of expansion and accumulation held by commercial farmers. So the private sector at this point, led by a Midwestern bean farmer, sought to collapse these distinctions. And this woman, Farmer Brown, as she was called, said that this instrument constructed an unhelpful and unrealistic dichotomy between being a smallholder and being a business. She said, farmers farm for a living, and their farms are businesses even when they're small. And over the course of these negotiations, the dispute over the meaning of farmer grew acrimonious. One activist from Canada yelled out in the plenary, if farmers are the private sector, then we need to create another sector called the monopoly sector. So the meaning of farmer was really never settled. But the flattening of distinctions between commercial farmers and smallholders, the private sector, through this flattening, the private sector and other powerful stakeholders drew on this egalitarian networked representation of society and economy to suppress hierarchies of value that differentiate distinct values and aims in which smallholders practice agriculture. And social movements have argued in response that collapsing these hierarchies simply subsumes smallholders into global value chains, expanding the disciplinary logics of capitalism through a new era of enclosure. So in the end, civil society members and social movements were disappointed by the results of the REI. And one social movement strategist said, you know, multi-stakeholderism really doesn't recognize asymmetries of power. That's why I'm always paying attention to process as well as content. And in this comment, she really reflected the fact that these network structures are reflected in the outcomes they facilitate. Through the REI, the principles on responsible agricultural investment, social movements and civil society endeavored not to simply challenge the proliferation of land grabs, but the prevailing practice and representation of the network. And this model of the network is one that excludes politics and control and models of conflict and control. So as a result, the norms that were produced through this neutral technology reflect the flattened hierarchies, reproducing entrenched asymmetries of power outside of this arena. So today, the network may be a hegemonic symbol of transnational law, but it's highly contested. And as distinct meanings and practices are imbued into structures of governance, it should be our goal as legal analysts to illuminate the struggles over this field of legality. Moreover, since values always exist in ranked opposition to one another, we have to excavate the always present hierarchies that are produced implicitly or explicitly through networked governance. Indeed, when these hierarchies are implicitly constructed, networks may simply reproduce the market in new forms. So I think the launch of TLI is therefore an exciting and important moment for this intervention. By bringing together scholars working from multiple disciplinary perspectives, by training graduate students, by offering a global hub for critical engagement in this contested legal field, the Institute really invites an opportunity not only to better understand the structures and processes and actors of transnational law, but the emergent cartographies of power in our evolving global normative order. Moreover, by embracing law in empirical, ethnographic, and theoretically sophisticated ways, the Institute is really poised to expand our ever-expanding horizons of global justice. Thanks.
So I want to start by saying how delighted I am to be here at this launch symposium of the Institute, and to thank Pierre and Helen and everyone for the invitation and for the work that they do in making this Institute such an exciting and dynamic place. My work was engaged with questions of transnational law long before I described it as being about that. So last summer, as I was in the final stages of a PhD project and struggling to coherently collate years of gathered materials, interviews and theoretical explorations around the rise of transnational carbon markets as a key site, as a key climate mitigation strategy, I was privileged to attend the Summer Institute here at King's, and that experience gave me the vocabulary and the frameworks to articulate my project as combining both the descriptive account of the transnational organisation of carbon markets is made up of public, private, as well as non-law elements, and global, national, and local processes, but also my acute political concerns about how those processes were establishing new forms of globalised authority and perpetuating and reinforcing inequalities that are already at the heart of the climate crisis. Combining these elements allowed me to argue that through carbon offset mechanisms, new forms of quasi-imperialist authority were being exercised over the forest areas in the global south in ways that risk foreclosing other avenues towards more just, climate-just futures. Soon thereafter, I moved to Austin in Texas to embark on a project examining the relationship between human rights and economic inequality, focusing on the thematic area of natural resource governance. In conceptualising this project, it immediately became clear that despite key struggles by third world states to assert permanent sovereignty over natural resources, and despite the fact that natural resource governance is generally formally understood to be within the legislative domain of the nation state, in fact, questions about who can decide which resources can be used by whom and under what conditions and how this decision making takes place is in fact addressed in a proliferating array of transnational governance sites. These governance sites might include the contractual arrangements between the host country and a transnational corporation that's extracting resources. It might take place in private forms of multi-stakeholder governance, such as the Forest Stewardship Council, or the Extractive Industries Transparency Initiative, or corporate social responsibility codes of companies. It might take place through the governance of project financing and loans from development or private banks. Through the international regimes governing trade or investment, the extraterritorial tort litigation in courts located in the company's home country, alleging harm to the people living in the sites, petitions to UN human rights bodies or regional human rights courts, or assertions of Indigenous sovereignty and law over those sites that deploy very different jurisdictional idioms. Some of these sites would conventionally be classified as national, others international, and other of these governance sites might not even be considered legal at all. However, I think the more acute analytical point is that these distinctions are not conceptually helpful in a world that's traversed by global supply chains in which many local decisions are already a product of many global imperatives. Moreover, the resources that are being governed are not static, but once extracted, are themselves travel through global supply chains, directed by dynamics of supply and demand that are at once local, national, and international in scale. So for example, that's the export of coal, that's the import, and this is the overlaying of all the different transactions and the complexity involved. In her book, The Deadly Life of Logistics, geographer Deborah Cohen pays attention to the entire network of infrastructures, technologies, spaces, workers, and violence that make the circulation of stuff possible that's so often tucked out of sight. Her account highlights the way in which the movement of commodities and the management of supply chains involved elaborate political, financial, material, and legal transactions. So in thinking of resource governance, there's both the transnational governance of the extraction of resources as well as the governance of the transnational movement of these resources that needs to be taken into account. Returning to the first of these, in drawing attention to the various transnational sites where decisions over resource extraction and governance takes place, my objective is not merely to map or produce a typology of these sites, or to understand how order or stability is produced, or to analyse the different role that these sites play in norm production. Rather, my keen interest is in how these international spaces of governance are spaces of struggle. That transnational governance of natural resources is not smooth, but a product of interacting and competing claims of authority at different levels. For example, Indigenous communities might assert rights over land through their own idioms of law. But then if the concession for the company would be withdrawn, the company might assert rights and property claims over that same land vis-a-vis the state in international investment tribunals in a very different idiom of right, property and law. And these disputes are becoming more and more common. The transnational space is, as legal geographers have highlighted, made up of overlapping legal and jurisdictional claims, but also the gaps between them. These competing claims do not just call for technical harmonisation, rather they speak to political contestations about by what principles these resources should be governed, but even more acutely, who should have legal authority over these resources, who can speak in the name of what law, and where the proper sites of legal adjudication lie. Further, I'm interested in identifying how the proliferating places in which these struggles over the distribution of authority, benefits, access, decision-making power, and risk exposure in extractive industries take place. That is, understanding how diffuse transnational arrangements produce distributional consequences. Poverty, wealth, economic inequality are neither innate nor natural. Processes of impoverishment and unequal accumulation are produced, stabilised, and sometimes challenged through legal and institutional arrangements. In an increasingly globalised world, it's to these transnational sites of norm-making that we need to turn in order to understand these ways in which these distributional consequences are being produced. In drawing attention to how natural resource governance is a product of a complex array and layering of legal regimes, both public and private, I also hope to identify potential spaces of leverage and change for human rights intervention, activism, and advocacy. That is to examine how and where spaces are created for the formulation or denial or the mobilisation or obstruction of rights claims. But further, the hope is that a transnational methodology will push for more critical self-reflection about the future of human rights frameworks themselves and the ways in which our conceptions of rights, which remain embedded in a citizen-sovereign model, themselves might need to change in order to call for justice within globalised economies and confront some of the more pressing justice problems of our day. Yet to stop there would be to name only half the story and to ignore the fact that contestation to inequitable modes of resource extraction is already taking place through transnational civil society networks. And this map shows, I think, a very limited snapshots of the points, sites of contestation around coal extraction. In her book, This Changes Everything, journalist Naomi Klein spoke of Blockadia as a transnational movement against fossil fuel extraction that conceptually linked multiple place-based struggles. We can see Blockadia in actions where communities along infrastructure routes such as pipelines or transport routes such as ports link or connect their different struggles together. Yet these transnational connections between struggles are not only articulated on the basis of a shared no, but can also, as in experimental processes such as the International Treaty to Protect the Sacred from Tar Sands Project, or this International Treaty to Protect the Salish Sea, between various Indigenous nations, be experimenting with and express very different forms of legality or transnational legality that we should also be paying attention to. Here, a transnational legal pluralist perspective can highlight how even speaking about resource governance as a matter of concern already presupposes a specific epistemology and a specific understanding of what law is. There is, for example, a vast difference between legalities that see land as something to be governed by law and legalities, for example, that might see the land itself as a source of law. These reflections highlight for me the importance of the transnational as a methodological perspective. Rather than a perspective that looks on a globe from a bird's eye view and assumes that norms apply in universal or should apply in universal terms, transnational law, I think, is a methodological orientation. It's focused, as the prefix trans implies, on the across, the beyond, and the through. It stresses that we're always looking from somewhere and that this situatedness has implications both for our epistemological claims that are making, our commitments, and our ethics of engagement. Moreover, it highlights how legal space and legal regulation is uneven and differentially patterned, heterogeneous, and producing differentiated effects in different places. These differences reflect both structural inequalities that need to be challenged, but also plural life worlds that we need to allow spaces for.
little bit of an exchange here. So you come from that side. So should I start immediately? Okay, thank you very much. Let me start with a question, and that is a question that I was asking myself after having taken a look into the program. So why should I talk about the politics of international law at the launch of a transnational law institute? So how can I make sense of this indeed accidental shift from the transnational to the international on the program? So I thought about that for a while, and on the flight from Hamburg, I came to a conclusion that the solution would be to delete the adjectives at all and talk about the politics of space without international or transnational. And I hope I'm able to make clear why that is. So, the politics of space, of course, borrows from Henri Lefebvre. And this is indeed where very much of this, what I'm going to talk about, is coming from. So there is this consideration of space in critical geography, and legal geographers, who very much borrow from critical geography, of course, they tell us that law corresponds to a certain space, but that this space is by no means a pre-given space. Instead, space is to a certain extent always produced by the law. And if these geographers or law and geographer scholars are right, and I very much think that that they are right, then the politics of law and the politics of space must go together. And this is very much what I'm interested in my work and here in this talk. So if we can say that domestic law creates domestic space and international law creates international space, what kind of space would then emerge from transnational law? So of course, the easy one would be to say transnational space. But I think that this is too simplistic and not a proper answer to the question. So let me think a little bit about that. And I will do so by starting with a brief anecdote. And this anecdote relates to a workshop on regulating world society. So now guess who organized this workshop. That was, of course, Per. And he brought together a group of about 20 postdocs from different fields, like not only lawyers, there were anthropologists, sociologists, and me, the political scientist. And we came together for 2 weeks in Berlin, and then the same group 1 year after for 2 weeks in Bloomington, Indiana. So that was a really intense and wonderful workshop. So if this institute here will be only half of the stimulating as this workshop was, you can all be lucky. Now, we read a lot, we discussed tons of literature, and in the morning hours we had guest speakers. And one morning, our guest was a judge who decided one of the alien tort statute cases in the US. So these lawsuits against, very often against multinational corporations for human rights violations, which were conducted mostly in the global south, so not on US American soil. But nonetheless, these cases were brought to the US court system. So that judge, he really had to say a lot about that. It was highly interesting. And it felt that he really belongs to sort of a vanguard of transnational law. I was really impressed. But at the same time, I became skeptical, like always. And when the Q&A started, I asked the question, what was your first thought when you had that case on your desk? And that judge, he did not really think long about that question. He immediately answered, what the hell is this doing in the United States? And here I was really wondering how this obviously territorial mindset, which is at work, comes into being, and why this is or seems to be so natural to keep with this territorialism in a way. And especially, of course, with such a transnational, let us call him a transnational judge. So what does this episode tell us about the spatiality of law, and especially the spatiality of transnational law? So that is actually what interests me here. And in fact, after this workshop, I started what I would now call a spatial analysis of transnational human rights litigation. And one of the things that I found so interesting about that was that there were so many different actors of world society, if you like, involved. There were like government actors, corporations, NGOs, law professors, more or less every type of actor in world society you can think of, intervening in these cases by means of amicus curiae briefs, for instance. So, but what they were doing is not only sort of fighting for the right interpretation of some human rights norms, but what they were doing is to bring up spatial narratives or geographical narratives by which their legal arguments worked out. So there were these narratives, in a way, put to work for a certain purpose. A geographical knowledge to make a legal argument work. So that is what I was really interested in here. So what is at stake in these kinds of struggles is obviously the meaning of space, or the meaning of jurisdictional space. So however space is constructed, different legal moves become possible. And I think that this is a very important insight for transnational law. So you could call that a legal geography at work, but a very political type of legal geography, because it so much relates to the production and reproduction of normative order here. So I think that this is really a major issue for transnational law and transnational legal theory, to ask how law relates to space. And what legal geographers tell us is that there is never the space of a certain type of law. So there cannot be the space of transnational law. So regulatory space, and I think transnational law is very much about regulatory space, regulatory space is never a neutral category. And it is not neutral in the same way as state space is not neutral. So if you say that domestic law or state law creates state space, well, this created space is not a neutral space. It makes possible certain things and it makes impossible other things. So transnational law is not neutral right in this sense, but the difference between domestic law or state practice and transnational practice may be that state space is currently assumed to be natural. It is naturalized, if you like, in an ongoing process. And this is what causes hard times for transnational law, I would say, because to raise the argument that state space is not natural, that it is produced for a certain purpose, that's a tough one, a tough argument to be made. But now in transnational situations, as Philip Jessup calls them, kick in. And here I would argue that these transnational situations open up sites for, for a reconstruction of space, if you like. These sites are sites in which this assumption that state space is the natural space is not so strong. So here the possibility is to deterritorialize space, to denaturalize state space, if you like. And this is very much where I think transnational legal theory should look at. Do I have 1 or 2 minutes left? Okay, so then let me come back to this international, transnational thing. Would you have launched an international law institute here? I think nobody, only two or three old guys were here. So perhaps this is not so interesting. And the argument which is always made is that the term international is way too narrow. And it does not match the complexity of the, let's say, transnational constellation. Here's just a thought. So in my field, international relations, which in Germany is a subdiscipline of political science, the same argument is raised very often. So international is way too narrow. You can only analyze relations between states or even between state governance with that. But the term international is not necessarily that narrow. So think of Marx's Communist International, which has not so much to do with the relation between state governments. But Marx, for some reason, did not call it the Communist Transnational. So why is that? Congratulations to the launch of this institute.
Good afternoon. Can I begin by acknowledging Per Zumbansen and his extraordinary leadership in bringing this Transnational Law Institute together in a short space of time. Helen Bandari, the extraordinary work that she does at the Institute, and indeed the leadership of Professor David Caron, Professor Ben Bowling in growing this law school as a centre for transnational legal education. My topic today in these short minutes is the space of transnational law between doctrine and diplomacy, between the development of public international law and the ongoing process of diplomacy as between states, which is so fundamental to that process. And what we have seen over decades, but particularly in recent years, is the growth of a complex constellation of actors in multiple issue areas, multiple domains, which are intervening in that process, which are in some cases governing its development and in many cases are crucial to its implementation. So I will be following Julia in concentrating on climate change, but these are comments that I suppose could be made across multiple issue areas. I will begin by trying to situate transnational law as between doctrine and diplomacy, before moving on to discuss this in action in the particular field of climate change under the UN Convention, and then talking about how this conception of transnational law, what it offers us in research, in teaching, and indeed in transnational lawyering itself. So transnational law, it's endlessly contested, but I would submit that whether one is talking about actors, norms, and processes, as Per does, or whether one is talking about transnational legal orders, a central part of the inquiry is locating agency, locating who is in control, who is able to bend agendas and outcomes to suit their interests, and which interests end up on the cutting room floor. This is crucial, as we've already heard, in climate change diplomacy, but also in so many other fields. And there are two payoffs to that. One of them is that as analysts, as scholars, this investigation of agency helps us to understand what is happening in the development of international law beyond the black letters that emerge from the conferences of parties. But also as practitioners, as activists, dare I say it, as lawyers, it helps us to work through these processes if we have a normative or a policy agenda. So transnational law and the world's biggest challenges. Obviously, climate change is one of these, but there are many challenges which have been grouped under the title of planetary boundaries, of where the Earth's system is being run up against its boundaries, and the need for policy interventions, for legal regulation, is urgent. Transboundary problems of pollution on a grand scale, which no single process of the United Nations or no single jurisdiction has proved able to deal with in and of itself. So, diplomacy, international relations, and here in deference I should say that I speak of international relations not as the scholarly discipline with capital I, capital R, but the process, the thing that we study. Diplomacy has changed, but in some ways it remains very traditional, that states send their negotiators who spend weeks in rooms, often closed to the public, closed even to observers, and eventually a text emerges, which countries then subsequently ratify or not. This remains the experience in climate change and in so many other fields. And the outcomes, some of them, not all, find their way into the doctrine of public international law. In this case, that doctrine captured in the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, agreed in 1992, but very much a framework convention, which set the scene for ongoing negotiations through 21 conferences of parties to try and bring the goal of preventing dangerous climate change within reach. We have doctrine of public international law also including customary international law. Some of those customs were codified in the Rio Principles. Many of them inform the ongoing development of climate change. Doctrine and diplomacy. Some changes, but in many ways, a very familiar scene. But what we have currently intervening in these processes are complex constellations of actors who owe their seat at the table of negotiation or implementation not to the accountability or legitimacy of state sovereignty, but to economic weight, to creative activism, to the mobilization of constituencies, whether these are farmers, however defined, whether these are businesses, whether these are activists, indigenous, the list goes on. And there are many networks, we've already heard about networks, but networks as a tool that these constituencies, these commonalities of interest, organize themselves into to maximize their impact at this stage. And the key thing that I would submit about this process is that it is not a process set up in opposition to the development of public international law. What's really interesting is the interfaces between the public international law, the international organizations of the United Nations, and these formal, informal, public-private hybrid networks. And the one example I would set for you is the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change's technology mechanism. Again, a product of public international law, 2010 Cancun outcomes, international negotiation in the traditional form. The nations of the world decided to set up a technology mechanism to accelerate the development of climate change technology and the transfer of such technology to developing countries. What's interesting about this for our purposes is it set up an institution called the Climate Change Center and Network, which is housed within the United Nations and provides technical assistance to developing countries. From a transnational perspective, what's interesting is that the United Nations does not do the work. The work of this organization is actually outsourced to a network of dozens of organizations from the public sector, the private sector, research institutions, regional organizations. And it is they who collaborate with developing countries who request technical assistance. And it is they who assist developing countries in changing perhaps their regulations, their legislation, in capacity building for programs. Here we have one example of the jurisdictional touchdowns that transnational law opens up before us. That a network of actors from beyond the UN system, but seeded within the UN system through a conference of party decisions, is working directly with national and subnational governments on their regulation with regard to climate change. Transnational climate finance is another example. I won't go into it in detail. But before I move on, I would say that not just is the implementation of climate technology transfer and development, transnational in this sense, but so is its elaboration. The technology mechanism of the United Nations has a steering committee which meets regularly in Bonn, and I attended its last meeting a few weeks ago. And the interesting thing about its deliberations is that the national representatives meet on technology for climate mitigation, adaptation, and so forth. But they also include in their deliberations representatives from the research constituencies, business community, environmental activists, all of them sitting around a table, everyone able to volunteer a view. Now, of course, there are still prerogatives, of course, there are still particular advantages that the state representatives have in this process, but it is not just them at the table. The process has changed. So, to take these insights that transnational legal research puts before us and apply them to research, what we have tried to do here at the TLI, and I'm indebted to Pear for this, is to create a research group on transnational regulatory governance, which has had the good fortune to bring scholars from London, but also from further away, to research how related challenges of energy, climate change, and technology can be managed in innovative interventions across borders. In terms of teaching, I had the great good fortune to participate in the transnational LMM pathway in the climate change module led by Dr. Eloise Scottford. And it is remarkable. Some of the students are here today, and it is remarkable the way that the students who study these programs are engaging with this question of agency, not just with the constitutional forms or the public international law doctrine, but with who is actually pushing through their agendas, how are these networks forming, and for whom. And finally, transnational lawyering, that we have the creation of institutions now which are neither particularly public nor private, neither solely international or solely national. I like to refer to transnational natives in the same way that we have digital natives, which were formed in that context, who have never known a different world. And as we see with some of these institutions, they are looking for lawyers who can engage, who have that curiosity in novel areas of law as a core competence. That is something that the Transnational Law Institute has been seeking to impart. That is something that is so important to lawyering in our world today, and long may that continue. Thank you.
Hi, good afternoon. First of all, I want to thank the organizers and dear Helen for the invitation. I would like to use this time to briefly reflect on the work that Transnational Law Institute has been carrying on in contemporary fast-changing world. So to do so, I will use this picture that's called Academy by Lamplight by Joseph Wright. And I like this picture because, so if you can look at the picture for a minute, you're gonna see there young students paying varying degrees of attention to the sculpture they should draw. This painting uses the Italian Renaissance technique of chiaroscuro, which is the artistic technique of light modeling using strong contrasts by the value gradation of color and the analytic division of light and dark. And so every object in the chiaroscuro painting finds its relevance according to the illumination it receives. If you would walk by and give a quick glance at the chiaroscuro painting, we may be left with the impression that the painting is about that statue, maybe to young person wandering around it. Now, the chiaroscuro technique is a challenge to our senses. It plays with the fact that people tend to see just what is illuminated. So now let's imagine this picture as a visual metaphor of knowledge production in the academic world. In certain times and spaces, different objects and fragments of the world tend to be highly illuminated, Much of the concentration goes to inquire upon that which is under the spotlight. So one may see the work of the Transnational Law Institute as a new spotlight over transnational law inquiries. However, once we take a closer look at the activities the Institute has been developing in only 1.5 years, we can see their innovative approach is by no means just a new spotlight. The Transnational Law Institute works as an encompassing umbrella to bring together plural understandings and approaches. The knowledge and events produced at and by the Institute have welcomed different perspectives on transnational law and have set them into dialogue. The transnational here can be an object of study, an approach, a method, a concept, a program, even a pedagogic challenge. The transnational can be a new approach to old concepts, as in the notion of transnational governmentality, or can be a collection of formalized legal norms and actors practicing law across national jurisdictions, as in transnational legal orders, or can be understood in line with renewed and traditional ideas around globalizations as assemblages of power and relations of legalities, or it can refer to the specialization shift in political economy and movements across political boundaries. The transnational here can be a method located processually through actors, norms, and processes constituted across time and space. It can be a challenging breakthrough for comparative law research. It can be a site for emancipation from below, a site of insurgent encounters. I have not found in the Transnational Law Institute any unspeakable words. Every notion, every idea, every concept can be in the dock. Capitalism, democracy, sovereignty, the rule of law. Even the academic world itself, with its logics and exclusions, it all gets to be unpacked and critically assessed. They've opened the Institute to inquiries that, at first glance, seemed as having nothing to do with the transnational law agenda. As the chiaroscuro technique is a challenge to our visual senses, the Transnational Law Institute is a challenge to our scholarship senses. The Institute is inviting us to see beyond our own scholarship preconception, beyond what we tend to illuminate in our own areas of studies. When I first came to the summer school last year, we were invited to write down in a yellow paper block any idea we would have for a research project, so that would circulate around and other people could put their names in it. So we did so and we started a group. That was the beginning of a sustained exchange that me and other 11 scholars from all around the world have been carrying on for the last 10 months. So driven by the question on how are transnational dynamics shaping local struggles in the legal realm, we have studied a reading club, a syllabus, a 3 years research project. We have started developing key questions and common vocabulary, and we have been accepted as a collaborative research group for the Law and Society Association in Mexico 2017. We are scholars from Japan, Maldives, Italy, Brazil, Colombia, Australia, Canada, India, the US, the Netherlands, Argentina. The summer school was for us not just a training program, but rather a platform from where to start exchanges we could not have had otherwise. So an innovative proposal as that yellow paper block became the seed for sustained exchanges. The Transnational Law Institute brings together not just scholars, but also practitioners, activists, policymakers, and set us in a creative dialogue otherwise disregarded in today's fragmented division of labor. In this fast-changing world, national borders have proven to have limited analytic power to comprehend current social and legal configurations. This institute is pointing at the fact that transnational dynamics are challenging, shaping, and shifting those areas of study we used to think as locally bounded. And these questions, traditional legal education and methods at its very roots. The law curricula in most parts of the world remain attached to the hegemonic understanding of law as equal to state modern law. In this schema, transnational forces operating through, in, out, and beyond the state get to be effaced in the representations of law. The transnational should be an approach, a method, a constant inquiry, an object of study, a concept, and a program, because the transnational is all around us. That what remains in the shadows is neither absent nor is it passive, even if for indifferent bystander may remain unseen. Neither chiaroscuro paintings nor transnational dynamics are for indifferent bystanders. They claim for our attention. We have to stop and look deeper into it to comprehend what is happening. That is the Institute's constant invitation, and this is why I think it is emerging as a privileged site for socio-legal imagination and knowledge production. Thank you.
Okay, 10 minutes. Off we go. Thanks for the invitation. Happy launching. I'm very happy to be here. And in 10 minutes, I brought a few pictures. So in Per's chapter in Beyond Territoriality, he posed the question about the nature of law when, in the context of transnational law, law should or could be resurrected. And he asked the question if law is to be understood as a tool or as a mean of oppression, or on the other hand, or as a mean of emancipation. So I'll focus or highlight three dimensions that I think, and that they have already been mentioned, that I think are important in transnational law or a transnational law method, that I think will suggest that law, or specifically international law in my case, is both or has both a dimension of oppression and resistance. So what is my context? My context is I'm a public international lawyer who mostly writes about history, but who writes about history in weird places, that is, non-Western locations. And I think that highlighting these three dimensions of transnational law shows that the histories of international law in those places is transformed, and as I mentioned already, it illustrates or illuminates not only the history of domination, which is most commonly emphasized, but also the history of resistance. So my talk is called something about before self-determination. So the idea is that today we think about international law as offering certain avenues for peoples who do not have sovereignty, and those avenues exist only since the 1960s, and that is self-determination. What would have been the avenues for acquiring sovereignty for peoples who did not have sovereignty? And the common idea is that there were no avenues that were legal avenues, and therefore the only way of achieving sovereignty was through military or political means. So I think if one highlights the aspects of transnational law or a transnational law method that I'll mention in a second, a different history emerges. So what, there are these three obvious that were already mentioned. One is that transnational law connects not just public international law regimes, but also domestic law regimes. Second, that is not only focused on legal sources that come from public law, but also from private law, and moreover, non-state or soft law or other ways of articulating legal arguments. And finally, I think the most important for me is to highlight something that is obvious since Jessup, which is that transnational law is a problem-oriented methodology, which is it tries not to describe just what the legal situation is in terms of law in the books, but it tries to describe law in action in relation to specific actors that are trying to solve specific problems. So here are my, I'm doing very well, 3 minutes.
two examples. I'm bringing two examples. One from a book that I published with CUP a year or so ago, which is called Mestizo International Law, A Global Intellectual History. And then I focus on another example of my next book to be published by, I don't know who. So this is 19th century international law. I'm bringing just one little example about Japan. And the idea would be that the mainstream view or the dominant perspective on the history of international law in places like Japan, we could say China or other non-Western countries, is that there was a military domination that was legitimized by international law. Therefore, international law was mostly a tool of oppression, and that resistance was military and did not involve international law. So I think a transnational law perspective would highlight the unequal treaties in this case. So the Western powers arrived to Japan or China, etc. They impose an unequal treaty. What transnational law add to that is that we would focus on the Western merchants who would be, for example, in Osaka. Let's assume they're English or British merchants there. They have contracts with locals, merchants. If there is a conflict between them, a legal conflict, it would not be solved by domestic courts. It would be solved by the British consul. So that's called consular jurisdiction. And this whole regime relies on a legal theory or a doctrine, which is the standard of civilization. In this context, the mainstream story is, well, there's oppression, and somehow you have to get out of that through military means. The book tells a different story, is that the military means are not enough. They have to be accompanied by a legal strategy. And here is one quick example. There is the war between China and Japan, and we have a lawyer here producing the argument that if you wage war respecting the laws of war, you are showing civilization, and if you show civilization, then you can renegotiate unequal treaties and to move from formal equality from formal inequality to formal equality. So that would be Nagao Riga. And then I have another example of another Japanese who is writing in German, criticizing the standard of civilization. Now, here comes the transnational law aspect that more narrow international law perspective would not understand, which is that the international legal argument, internalizing the standard of civilization, is connected to the renegotiation of the unequal treaty in order to get rid, to abrogate consular jurisdiction, in order then to have the British merchant to be governed by Japanese domestic law. And that is the success. So the success is not measured in terms of just the renegotiation of the treaty, but in terms of the various regimes and legal rules coming from private and public international law. And note that also the technique is only retrievable or visible if one looks through transnational law terms. So here, in both cases, the method, the strategy is writing article or writing a book and then intervening in the legal discourse in order to change the meaning of the doctrine. 16th century Spanish conquest, so the Spanish conquest of Peru, that would be the traditional historical understanding from an international law perspective of what happened when the Spaniards arrived into the Inca Empire. And here again, through a transnational law perspective, what would we get is a very different story, a story that in 2 minutes would include a series of capitulations. That is, some of those are public contracts between, in this case, Pizarro and Almagro and the crown that would grant them the collection of tributes, the grants to exploration and exploitation and encomiendas, the slave, quasi-slave system of indigenous exploitation. But then also a series of contracts between the members of the companies that were doing the conquest. And in that case, now where comes the resistance? Here we have a petition by an indigenous leader, Tito Cusi-Yupanqui, who in 1570 sends this petition to the king and recounts what his father was telling to Pizarro, which is, unlike the justifications that Spaniards had given officially to the conquest, which are very important for the history of international law, namely the justifications in the context of the jus gentium, the laws of people, which is hospitality, travel, and trade, the Inca said, rather than that, it's all about greed. And if there is greed, there is no just cause for you Spaniards to be here. And if there is greed, there is no justification. And that would be something that only through transnational law you could get. But there is one last thing, which is, where does greed come from? And the idea would be, again, a story that doesn't appear in conventional histories, is that Pizarro had to get gold because the crown, he had been given a grant by the crown to invest in this compañía that was doing the conquest, financed by a network of investments that can be traced from Peru to Spain to Genoa. And in order to pay interest, greed was, and exploitation was the final story. Thanks.
Should be somewhere on the left here. Yeah. Thank you so much. Dear colleagues, dear students, dear peer, my contribution to the launch of this exciting new Transnational Law Institute focuses on a photograph taken in 1917. And I am sure next year we will come across this picture in many ways in the context of the centenary of the Russian Revolution. I hope, dear peer, I can explain why my highest estimation for your work is gift-wrapped as an analysis of a photograph that apparently seems a widespread picture of German war propaganda, but reveals a hidden and almost unknown message. And at latest now, you're not surprised that I am a historian. I am specialized in global history, and I'm working in an interdisciplinary institute for European global studies. And I will explain a little bit later what European global studies means. But I would like to focus on my field of expertise, which is global history. So back to this picture. The picture documents the moment when the victorious German Field Marshal, Prince Leopold von Bayern, signs the armistice between Germany and his allies and Russia in Brest-Litovsk on December 15, 1917. A well-known producer of propaganda postcards, namely the German photographer Paul Hoffmann, had taken the picture, and the picture went properly to military censorship, and therefore we can say that this document is a semi-official document. On the left-hand side, you can see the victorious party, the representatives of the winning coalition seated around the supreme commander of the Eastern Front. And on the right side, there are the representatives of the defeated Russian army. Obviously, the picture has captured a moment of profound historical transition, and that in more than one respect. At the Eastern Front, a military coalition based on old monarchic regimes had defeated another old regime, but one which had already come to an end with the revolution in October 1917. For the Russian side, the Bolsheviks had taken over the negotiations about the armistice. Interestingly, the German representatives seemed to rely on the assumption that a group of Bolsheviks dressed in shabby plain clothes would follow international rules about the formal ending of wars. Did they? The question is, who is actually the most dangerous person in this picture? The highly decorated field marshal? I doubt. In the inner ring, there is only one person who looks directly into the lens of the camera. And may I ask you to click, make one click? Thank you. Seated prominently vis-a-vis the victorious field marshal, this person seemed to endure the legally important moment of the signature, and most disturbingly, the person is a she. Even worse, Anastasia Alexeyevna Vitsenko came directly from a Tsarist prison, where she served a long life sentence for murdering Prince Leopold's alter ego, a Russian general. With this knowledge, the well-arranged photograph suddenly turns to a highly ambivalent picture. It shows much more than an armistice. It documents the end of Europe's social foundation of power. It predicts the end of those who proudly present themselves at this very moment as victors of the war. However, this threat obviously escaped the German military censorship and also the historians' attention. Neither the contemporary viewer nor the historians even expected to see in such a moment a woman. Since diplomatic services and military staff were women-free zones at this specific historical moment. This picture made his journey through German school books. Again, teachers and students have overlooked what was not part of their mental map, namely to find a woman and a murderer at the negotiation table. The picture is therefore a strong visualization of power encaged in an oxymoron. The presentation of victory seems to confirm a still existing script of 19th century diplomacy. However, the subtext erodes the foundation of presumed rules, structures, and power relations. What are we doing with these findings? In one of the last numbers of the American journal Diplomatic History, developed a quite interesting debate, unusual for this journal, and the topic of this journal is nämlich a debate about queering America, about how to use LGBTQ studies for analyzing international relations. Or to take it in the way how one participant, Laura Belmonte, said it, I quote, "The question is how constructs of sexuality and otherness have shaped policy, undergird notions of citizenship, and informed transnational networks of state and non-state actors and activists." End of quotation. So it's not at all about forgotten women. It's not about to tell a history of Vitsenko, of the person here on the slide. It's not even about to introduce LGBTQ studies into our methodological framework, but the gender line, I think, is very helpful because along the gender line, you have all sorts of overlapping systems with regard to law, to economy, but also to history. For a historian interested in the emergency field of global history, these hidden parts of the past are of increasing interest. It has never been the aim of global history to cover the whole world in a geopolitical sense. It's, as mentioned already here, it's more about the perspective, more about the methodology than about a topic. So global history, always in this interdisciplinary context, shares a set of assumptions with, I think, transnational law. First of all, both fields share the assumption that it is important to initiate a sea change with regard to topics beyond the Western nation state. In both fields, the analytical use of multi-layered and matrix-related contents are of importance, and they want to overcome Eurocentrism and methodological nationalism. In both fields, practices, the way how things have been done, have increased in importance compared to conceptual normative thinking. And in both fields, the porosity of borders, the limit of sovereignty and entanglements instead of comparatism are linked with the interdisciplinary approach. What do we gain? By giving up the idea that globality only manifests on scales of international relations and diplomatic history, a variety of actors and social practices have come into the focus. The many Swiss remigrating confectionaries and cheesemakers, to make an example, all these people imprinted their mountain villages of origin with neo-Renaissance palazzos, and many of the tiny local museums still have dusty world maps covered with pins documenting the spread of the citizens around the world, as an example for those who never left the village. An international civil society, therefore, is obviously not just a projection of a utopian world society, just as little as the millions of tweets connected globally future historians will have to analyze, and I'm happy I don't have to do that. I'm going not too far in pursuing a common interest in those hidden corners my photograph is part of, actually. I'm working on a letter the Federal Department of Foreign Affairs in Switzerland addressed to the Chinese minister in Bern in 1946. In this letter, Switzerland declared to officially abstain from Swiss extraterritorial rights in China, and I'm very happy that Arnulf already mentioned how important these extraterritorial rights are. Now, Swiss prerogative in China's, they don't have paper trails. They relied on a hybrid construct based on a system of most favored nation clause. The governmental involvement remained completely invisible and came literally into existence in the moment of the renouncement, but not before. Coming back to what we are doing with all these nice stories. When we launched in Basel a European Global Studies program in 2014, we were not sure students would agree to follow us. After all, the former comparison between countries shifted now towards an analysis of European relational networks within and outside of Europe. In the meanwhile, the interest in interdisciplinary cooperation between law, economy, history, and political science has substantially increased. Students and more colleagues are willing to face the intellectual adventure of establishing a critical global narrative that overcomes teleological presumption. Coming back to my picture, however, I have nothing positive to tell. Anastasia Bitsenko was executed in 1938 after one of Stalin's show trials. She ended as a victim of the new social system which she had so convincingly represented in one global moment when the photograph clicked. Historians are pessimists by profession. But having the honor to participate in the launch of the Transnational Law Institute, there are excellent reasons for optimism. I see a future generation of young scholars that are able to think out of the box and can make sense of the multi-layered challenges the 21st century has to offer. Thank you very much.
Also, thank you very much for the opportunity to be here today. And I'm very impressed by the presentation so far and all the new insights and perspectives on transnational law, on global history. It's kind of challenging to to start now again with global history. And for me, it seems that the approach of kind of transnational law is also a part of a perhaps uncoordinated broader project of transnationalizing the humanities or transnationalizing social and legal studies in general. In the field of history, this attempt of transnationalization tries to overcome these narrow national boundaries empirically as well as methodologically. The effort for a global historiography seems already like preaching to a choir, at least if we judge by a kind of casual reference to transnationality one finds in virtually almost every ambitious research project nowadays. So in the field of global history, is committed to overcoming traditional national historiographies and aims to overcome what was already said, the methodological nationalism as well as an inherited Eurocentric perspective which had shaped historiography for almost 150 years. Therefore, global history is both an object of study as well as also a particular way of looking at history. It is both a process and a perspective, and it is also kind of a form of methodology. Global history could be understood as an historical analysis which puts processes and historical phenomena into a global context and rejects the internalist narratives which claim to explain national or even local phenomena without attention to kind of the external influences. So global history is shaped by new conceptions of space, as well as of a kind of more relational approach which clarifies that history never points only in one direction. It is about finding a common field of analysis between, for example, South Asia, the Arabian Peninsula, or East Africa, or between West Africa and Western Europe. So this is kind of one way of doing it. So global history tries to avoid this kind of one-dimensional analyzing, and by taking kind of global spaces as also an object of study and exemplifying the entanglements in which they are constituted. So, for example, in the case of colonialism, we arrived already at a crucial reorientation by acknowledging that colonialism not only happened to the colonized people, but also transformed the colonizers. So, example would be the Christian Basel mission, for example, had an impact on everyday life, of course, of the people in what is today Ghana, but as well as of the people in southern Germany and Switzerland, and how they kind of also perceived their religion and what kind of opportunities they have in kind of becoming a missionary. So in the same way, and it's a little bit kind of a more blatant, more kind of non-historical example, we could even talk about contemporary free trade policies not only affecting the global south, but also transforming Western societies. So there is a kind of this clear kind of connectivity which becomes kind of obvious by the kind of approach of global history. So global history is revealing the global connections, the coherences, entanglements, but it's also always a little bit at risk becoming a catch-all category, which overlaps with different approaches like transnational, translocal, transregional, entangled, trans history. Almost all topics can be basically studied from a global history perspective, and ranging from institutions to capital to migrants, as well as ideas, knowledge, trade, and so on. So, and furthermore, global history does not only have to be kind of a macro history of the globe, especially it should not be only a macro history of the world, but it's also bring together this kind of local and regional dimension of a global entanglement. In my current research, I'm looking at infrastructure projects in the 1960s and 70s in post-colonial Lagos, Nigeria, the country's capital city at the time. Let's take a look at one of these projects, the EcoBridge. The EcoBridge is, until today, the most important connection between Lagos Island to the mainland and one of the crucial infrastructural sites of the Lagoon City. It was built by the German company Julius Berger between 1965 and 1975 and became kind of a symbol for a very special Nigerian post-colonial modernity. In my research, I'm looking at this bridge as a global site that can serve as an example of entanglements of global and urban history and presents an opportunity to recount a history of development and capital aid from a non-state perspective. It is also history which about how technical knowledge, as well as experts, kind of the engineers and the urban planners, traveled globally. And we shall see here too, the project transformed the company in Nigeria as well as in Germany. The construction of the bridge, which was praised as the most modern bridge of Nigeria, was possible due to a global transfer of expert knowledge, which had been gained on construction sites in Turkey, in Sudan, as well as in Venezuela. The very same engineers who planned and built bridges in Asia and South America built the EcoBridge in Nigeria. Further, while Nigeria was suffering under extensive capital shortage, this infrastructural project and other business activities from Julius Berger were backed by export credit guarantees from the German government and the German development KfW, and from the 1970s onwards from the World Bank. So Nigeria's way of dealing with this kind of lack of capital offers insights in how actors from the global south try to bypass financial hierarchies. And one kind of very classical way of doing this was by kind of playing the Cold War dynamics. Basically saying, if we don't get this loan to this condition, we will go to the other side, which was then kind of in Hungarian investment or in Soviet Union investment. Still, this kind of financing of the EcoBridge also exemplifies or could exemplify the kind of contradictory effects on capital aid and how it was presented by kind of the German government, as well as inside the country as kind of helping humanitarian action, or even kind of presenting it towards the Nigerian government. And these effects on capital aid was also always a kind of problem on the kind of state sovereignty inside the global south. So far, kind of a short look into this, into kind of global, empirical kind of example of global history. But apart from the way empirical and methodological questions are recast in the context of global history, it is also raises a more ethical concern with the positionality of research itself. So global historians should ask themselves more intensively who, in fact, is writing the history. So who their audience are and what kind of universities are teaching it, so the global history. Where are the global arenas located? Is global history truly global or biased by a more Anglo-American academia? And who gets the access as well as the visas to places with relevant archival material? All these pressing issues go along with kind of a repositioning of the methodological focus, and they should. To borrow the words of also a global historian, Sebastian Conrad, we should understand global history as a form of self-criticism of globalization.
I'm delighted to talk about an interesting topic, which is comparative law and transnational law. I'd like also to thank Pierre and team for organising this, for inviting me back to King's. It doesn't seem that long ago that I was sitting there as a student at King's on, I think, what is the King's first outing in terms of transnational law, the Anglo-French programme, which I went through. And so that's that makes it even nicer to come back here to speak in the Anatomy Theatre, which I don't know if that was a deliberate choice or not of a location. We're going to be dissecting the notion on this desk, which no doubt cadavers are rolled out and dissected on. So we're doing the conceptual dissecting. And what I just want to say a word about is the relationship between comparative law and transnational law, suggested in the title, a kind of evolutionary process. But what I try to do is look at these concepts, these interesting dichotomy, as two relatives, maybe cousins, transnational law and comparative law, maybe sisters, maybe even mischievously, you could say, ugly sisters, two sisters who are brought together genetically in some ways, but also in other ways are very different. Why are they different? Well, I just want to say a word about that, and I want to say a word also about how they can work together, perhaps, feed into each other's different methodologies, different approaches. The two disciplines, the two topics, are they share common genetic backgrounds. There's no doubt about that. There is a shared DNA, a shared background in comparing and looking across transnational issues as well. And yet they have a very different trajectory. One sister, one cousin is a slightly older sister, more statesmanlike perhaps, but also a bit more austere and in some ways slightly frumpier version. Okay, I'm afraid that's comparative law. Transnational law is the younger cousin, the younger sister, more dynamic, more challenging, and maybe just more modern. And I think that those differences play across the stereotypes. And yet at the same time, I think there is a way of communication through that DNA, through that shared DNA. And there's a methodology, I think, which can root into those two, into that relationship. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to have a look at comparative law, some of the current issues, and try and suggest ways in which methodologies we've just seen throughout today, it's been quite stimulating hearing from everyone how some of those methodologies can be galvanized into the more austere discipline of comparative law. Now, there's been some surprising claims made about comparative law. My favorite comes from quite a surprising source, Nietzsche, who said in The Gay Science that what gives colour to existence? Love, avarice, envy, cruelty, of course, pious respect for tradition, and comparative legal studies. Now, that may be setting the stall a little high, I agree. But The heritage is there. One looks back, you cast back to, you have comparative archaeologists who can find examples throughout history, of course. Montesquieu, de Tocqueville, etc. You can see, one can see, even without that methodology, but that natural, the natural search and look to the other to inform one's own system. And the history is there, the heritage is there, but there was, of course, an important revival in the early 20th century, and we've seen, I think, of the last period, a kind of acceleration of that, even within systems such as the common law, where in many ways comparative use of other common law systems, maybe not civil law systems, that's much more exotic, much more challenging, but the comparative use, of course, of other common law systems has always been part of that discourse, whether in practice or academia or otherwise. Maybe a bit like Monsieur Jourdain, without particularly knowing it. Now, why is there a burgeoning use of comparative law? Well, that could occupy seminars, of course. But the reasons, I think, for the burgeoning use of comparative law feeds into some of the things we heard, I think, earlier on. That's why we see the bridge between the mixing metaphors, I'm afraid, the bridging between the relatives that we, the, those two dichotomies I mentioned earlier on. What are the reasons behind that? I think one of them is obviously increasing open textured nature of legal systems, the kind of self-structured, autonomous, classic approach to the nation has been broken down. And as that systemic breakdown occurred, that obviously has had repercussions in a whole lot of different areas. Norms, approach to norms, types of norms, structuring, etc. And comparative law has fed into that. Why has it fed into that? Well, within that pluralistic system that we heard talked about earlier on, within that pluralistic system, one looks to other sources. You try to structure sources, and looking to other legal systems provides that, in some ways, feeds into that. Polycentricity. Now, probably 50 years ago, people talked about increasingly complex systems, but I think we're living through an era where legal issues themselves are increasingly polycentric, complex issues, whether that's fundamental rights, whether it's constitutional review, whether it's international commercial law. And so again, I think that the complexity that then confronts the judge, the practitioner, the scholar, there's a natural resource then to look, and a resort rather to look to other sources viewpoints, and looking to how such complex issues are dealt with elsewhere is a natural response to that. And it's very interesting hearing from all the speakers earlier on about the way in which that the pluralism and the polycentricity of these issues, climate change, environmental issues, agriculture, etc. I don't think it's not surprising that, and the planetary, that kind of great graphic we had, the planetary issues, it's not surprising, I think, that we see transnational law itself naturally moving as a sort of form of osmosis towards those issues. And I think that's another point of convergence where we see comparative systems, comparative legal reasoning itself, if not dealing with love on the same level as love, avarice, etc., Nietzschean concept, but nonetheless having a role, I think, in dealing with some of these issues which by their very nature can no longer be dealt with on a national, regional level. There are many other issues. We have time to cover them all. International networks, international marketplaces for information, I think, is a hugely important issue as well. The US Supreme Court, the UK Supreme Court, civil law jurisdictions, etc., increasingly engaging either through formal networks, as we know, we all read and we've discussed partially earlier on, but I think informal networks as well, the way in which there's that discourse which traverses frontiers in a way which probably wouldn't have done not so long ago. And I think we see that as well. It's very interesting seeing that sort of process described in from historical perspectives, from other disciplines as well, which can inform our thinking. My final point is one which is also, I think, quite surprising, that despite what I've just said about comparative law being having a long heritage, being increasingly used, etc., it's become a surprisingly controversial topic. It's controversial for a number of reasons, but one may only have to look at the debate currently occurring in the US before the US Supreme Court, which bubbled into existence 4 or 5 years ago. It's again on the agenda with Breyer's book, The Courts and the Law, again focusing on issues of the utilization of non-domestic norms within the judicial process. And that it's not the only arena, but it's probably the most visible arena of that controversial nature of comparative law. Why is it controversial? Well, again, it engages with issues which are complex: constitutional legitimacy, reliability of sources, methodologies, of course, different non-domestic methodologies which challenge the traditional approaches to legal reasoning, to sources, to developing the law. Again, shift back to transnational law. I think what really struck me earlier today was not just really the way in which you're describing transnational law as a sort of in its substance, in its content, the way in which there is an identifiable methodology, there is an identifiable approach to the topic, and an interesting discussion about what is law as well, engaging the very nature of law. And my final point, I think, which I take away from the session, is there's a certain energy to what is being created here, and I obviously credit appear to that, in the sense that there's a real feeling for the way people describe their approach, their methods, and there's an enthusiasm in relation to this topic, which I hope predominantly as a comparative lawyer, we can galvanize somehow into developing that symbiotic relationship, I hope, between, on the one hand, comparative law, the older, austere sister, and the new dynamic modern transnational law discipline. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I guess I should move over a little more. I know that I stand between you and liquor. Well, almost. There's one other. But I know that, and I will try to be brief. My remarks, I thought a lot about what I can do here today, and my purpose, really, my remarks are offered to honor Pierre, and to honor Pierre's project, and it's in that context that I offer this to you as part of the launch of this wonderful new institute. There's a certain ritual in discussions of transnational law, one that worries about situating it within the contemporary ideological structures of law through state. We've done plenty of that today. And I'm all in favor of that as well, to some extent, that is ritual. I want to invert this ritual for my remarks, and I want to, in inverting the ritual, I want to situate law and the state within the transnational. And so I start with law and the state, and we'll see where we go. When I teach a course on, it's an introduction to US law and legal theory, I start with the fundamental question, what is law? Not what is transnational law, international law, migraine law, but I start with the question, the fundamental question, what is law? And that leads to a consideration, at least in our class, it leads to consideration of law's fundamental normative principles. For our purposes today, let's call it justice, right? And its process components. Let's call it certainty and predictability. But quickly, we come, our class comes to understand justice and process as inherently relational. From Justinian's institutes, give every person their due, to Marxist-Leninist determinist systems to move society towards a communist place. There are a lot of words, I'll use that one. To religion and its connection either to God or to nature, and we have a lot of both of those, right? And that takes us back first, I think, to custom and tradition, and through it, to fundamental notions of consent. And then we layer its systemic character, law's systemic character, the disciplines in law, well known, torts, contracts, administrative law, etc., and the architecture of its expression, common law, equity, statute, administrative regulation, and private authority. Only then, do we introduce the state and its institutional apparatus. With the state and its introduction, law mutates and shrinks as a separate and autonomous of the state, but now bound to public remediation and oversight. As an instrumental institutional expression of the state itself, here law and the state merge. It's with the introduction of the state, also, that a meta-legality is necessary, the more so the closer law is subsumed within its institutional apparatus. And if law is the state and the state is law, then a language of personal relations must be developed. Sometimes we call it comparative law, sometimes we call it international law. So when we speak to law generally, we've come to assume that it is embedded within and expressed through the state. Our conceit about, and it is a conceit, our conceit about and the construction of a political ideology of the state has appeared to fuse law and the state in a permanent union, a religious marriage of sorts, a permanent union, and in the process diminished law. We have come to believe that law wears the state's collar, or to use a 19th century expression for the union of a man and a woman, the state et ux. But Philip Jessup, innocently enough, as he sought to embed those human activities that could not be confined to a state, or even among them, within the state, because that was his project, really. He also followed this. He wanted to embed these human activities within the state, began a process that has proven that this union of law and the state is not merely a loveless match, but is also a perversion that explains only a small, though potent enough, part of what law is. And thus my provocation, although I suspect I've been provocative enough, and thus my provocation. Half a century from now, at gatherings like this of our grandchildren, right, they will look back, y'all will be old, someday, right, they will look back and marvel at the lunatic arrogance of a project that sought to confine law in and to the state. They may conclude that the madness of the Enlightenment, of metastasized scientism, of Napoleon and Marx and Anglo-American pragmatists and those who followed them, who sought to confine law to the state, for that is what their ideological lenses them only permitted them to see, that all of this did the enterprise of law a great injury. And that the law itself, they may also conclude, that the law that binds people, binds communities, enterprises, and states, indeed, that the law that binds itself without the state, but binds itself as itself, is not merely transnational, but transinstitutional as well. They may also conclude that one ought to study the law of the state in the way we presume today to approach the study of transnational law, as a subset of a much broader and more complex terrain of governance with an infinite variety, scope, jurisdiction, and practice, but with a common set of meta-principles that distinguish law from other forms of compulsion, but which require a change in approach to the way in which we understand politics, representation, consent, and justice. They may also conclude that principles of polycentric governance, we've just talked about it a little bit, will help broaden the increasingly inadequate mechanisms of conflicts of law, that language that we use that binds us to this bizarre notion of the marriage of law and the state, right? That it will broaden that and will alleviate the differential privileging of actions as lawmakers. And indeed, that arguments over the character of transnational law as method, field, substance, etc., you've heard them all, I hope, that these arguments over the character fail to recognize the meta-characteristics of transnational law as a description of the field of law itself. We've just been working backwards. Nietzsche once famously, again, we're the two Nietzsches today. Someone is going to kill us. Right? Nietzsche, but I'm not going to do gay sex. Right? Nietzsche once famously worried about the four great errors: inverting cause and effect, false causes, imaginary causes, my personal favorite, right? And a belief in free will. In the face of the realities of globalization, which itself might be understood as an effort to return to a more natural state of law beyond the state, we academics do ourselves a great harm by continuing to serve as the shills of an ideology of law that itself may be increasingly remote from the reality of its practice. And thus, perhaps, a manifesto of transnational law. Thank you.
So I'm going to bring the less academic note of a business perspective of a publisher on transnational law. So what's in a name? Actually, everything. What is transnational law and how does a publisher look at it? Actually, it's a bit of a headache, I have to say. So what I'm going to do is just talk through the kind of contradictions in what I hear transnational law is, and actually bring along a case study of a book at random that I picked from the shelf, European Constitutional Language, and just talk you through the kind of line of thinking that a publisher has to make about a new fad that comes along. Is transnational law a method? Some people say it is. Is it a new field? Is it law and context? Is it what law and context used to be? Is it socio-legal studies? Perhaps it's all of these things. But in a job like mine, what we have to do at the very beginning of a journey of a book is actually talk to the author and get some feel from the marketing team. And I'm going to just look at this in the context of a law publisher within an academic press, which is interdisciplinary. And one of the great advantages of Cambridge, of course, is that we can position projects in history. And I think the interdisciplinarity of what the innovation of the Transnational Law Institute is going on here is very exciting to me, because I think bringing history, bringing international relations, many law schools don't do that. So I certainly celebrate that with you. So help me on the journey of this book. European constitutional law. Where would you have put it? Can I point with this? Anyway, is it European law? Is it public law? Actually, it ends up being in jurisprudence. What's in a name? It's some ways the peer review sorted that out for us, and a quote from Mark Tushnet in Harvard Law School about the content being, you know, high-level legal theory sorted that out too. But but when transnational law crosses my desk, it reminds me, when I first came to Cambridge nearly 20 years ago, I had the great good fortune to virtually the first week meet James Crawford, who's obviously now a judge in the ICJ. And James, at that time, co-edited Cambridge Studies in International and Comparative Law. And I said to him, explain the difference. And he said, well, Fanola, all international law is comparative, but not all comparative law is international. I've always remembered that. As a business, international law is a huge field. I mean, it is more than 60% of our revenue. Comparative law is the little sister. Are they the same thing? Obviously not. When we work with another great advocate of this, your work here in this institute, Professor Sally Mary in NYU, we work with her in the context of law and anthropology, and law and history, and sociologists and non-lawyers coming to the field, and our empirical work we tend to place in that series. Another early career experience I had was meeting a young scholar called Michael Byers, B-Y-E-R-S, he's now at UBC in Vancouver. And he was writing on customary law, and I thought, oh, please, what is this? You know, and some of the debates around transnational law remind me of the definitions of customary international law. At the time of the Pinochet trial, which some of you may be too young to remember, there was a great debate in this country about, it's customary international law if I say it is. And sometimes when I, as a publisher, get book proposals and somebody tells me it's transnational law, I say, well, it's only because you're telling me that it's transnational law, and I'll have to set out to test this. Sounds familiar. William Twining, who is another giant in this field, has taught me about the context of law, about asking the question whether there is any context, social, is it political, is it historical? And if the answer to that is yes, well then it is that field. And with David Nelkin, who's here in the audience, I've debated sometimes, you know, how to perceive when law and context is not law and context. So can you see where my headache is coming from? Because at the end of the day, it seems to be that it's all things to all men and women and not all things to some. So when I come to classify things, I learn that really putting a book in socio-legal studies is not a good idea. Because essentially a book is usually about something else, and it's a methodology or it's an approach or it's a series that's socio-legal. And we find that people don't go looking for socio-legal, they go looking for contract, they go looking for European public law, they go looking for something. And socio-legal is sort of, it's a kind of branding, it's a second brush. And so my sort of challenge on transnational law is it a fashion, is it a fad? Or perhaps if this experiment is right, Peer, in 20 years' time, we won't even ask the question because everything will by then automatically be transnational and this kind of splitting of hairs won't go on. A challenge that is not the same as what I'm talking about is jurisdiction. And of course, law is a regional subject. So unlike my history or my anthropology or my political science editors who work alongside me, I don't have the luxury of the same book appealing to the same sort of readership, particularly at an undergraduate level. And indeed, I know William is no longer with us, but I know he wouldn't mind me sharing with you that we have not found as a publisher, Cambridge University Press, now Law and Context publishers, we have not found that the term Law and Context has had much resonance in North America. So it's remained a kind of European English term. And the opposite used to be true, actually, that law and society was something which I only went to America to hear about, and that the series editors were all there. Into the picture now comes Asia. I mean, certainly in my career in the last 5 years, Asia has really jumped up as kind of more than a new kid on the block. So I think it's going to be very interesting when we have this slightly more globalized field. Of course, it does cost money to do these things, so that's breaking down a little bit too. I mean, I would love to put all these series editors into one room and then ask them to define transnational law for me. But it has to have law, doesn't it? You can agree on that. And that's probably all we can agree on. What else can I talk about? So we're all law and context now. Perhaps we're all transnational now. I think at the end of the day, it's important to have good scholarship, And the classification with a publisher is really to do with the business of selling our content. So, you know, discoverability is everything. Metadata is the new kid in town. In future, we will be asking all authors to give us an abstract of their book chapters. This is a tradition that, you know, has been there in journals for a long time. There's quite a lot of resistance to this, but the point is that when a great young editor I work with, Elizabeth Spicer, who's really in love with transitional justice, and she says, Finola, where's transitional justice in the list? I go, it's probably in human rights, or it's probably in public international law. And so in some ways, there is a classification system that I have to work to in our database. It is only this number of fields. Perhaps I should retitle comparative law transnational law, or add it in. Why not? Perhaps I should, you know, so this kind of, like, it's a librarian's job as well. So classification differs, publishers differ, publishers' catalogues differ, authors differ, series editors differ. But I think at the end of the day, what, you know, Cambridge wants to be associated with is innovation, and, you know, we think transnational law is something we are very seriously here to work with you in developing further. That's all I have to say.
So now it's my great pleasure on behalf of the students and the institute to invite everyone to a little reception. Maybe in 20 minutes or so, once you've all found a drink, then the musicians will start a little concert. They actually emphasize that they don't want to provide elevator music or background music, but actually they've prepared songs and they would like us to pay attention to these songs, which I find very worthy. And after the four songs, then we will turn to other music, and then we'll continue the reception and the gathering and communicate with everybody and hopefully enjoy the concert. Thank you so much. Last thing, you will see that the room has been decorated. So under the wonderful guidance of Marius, this impeccably dressed Norwegian young man who left the room because he is in charge of everything today, the room was decorated by maps that he bought. He bought around 300 maps at Bitterfield Market, and he and a few other students today, they put them up in the room next door, and there's a certain system behind all this. So you might know more if you look at this. Mm-hmm.